Indians look at the term androgyny. The word androgynous was historically applied to humans with a mixture of male and female sex characteristics and was sometimes used synonymously with the term hermaphrodite. So this is the basic concept of androgyny, which more or less we know that male and female sexual characteristics are present in the same body, and the term hermaphrodite or hermaphroditic are used with respect to this androgynous body. When it is used to refer to physical traits, it often refers to a person whose biological sex is difficult to discern at a glance because of the mixture of male and female characteristics. Because androgyny encompasses additional meanings related to gender identity and gender expression that are distinct from biological sex, today the word androgynous is rarely used to formally describe mixed biological sex characteristics in humans. So, androgynous, the term basically refers to biological sexual characteristics, and today by gender we mean features which are not strictly biological but which are often social, psychological and so on. Therefore, we do not use the term androgyny unless we are referring to the biological features. In modern English, the word intersex is used to more precisely describe individuals with mixed or ambiguous sex characteristics. So, if we use the word intersex, this word is not only about biological characteristics. So in the umbrella acronyms to LGBTQ, you will often see I stands for intersex. So intersex includes the meaning of sexual as well as social, psychological, gender characteristics. Both intersex and non-intersex people can exhibit a mixture of male and female sex traits, such as hormone levels, type of internal and external genitalia, and the appearance of secondary sex characteristics. So, those who are non-intersex people, that is, those who do not strictly identify themselves as androgynous or hermaphroditic, even they have male or female traits or male and female hormones. For example, we know that everybody has some female hormone as well as male hormone. But in those who we call men, among them the male hormones are released in a greater quantity, and those we call women, among them the women hormones are released in a greater quantity. So one part of the definition of sex also includes hormones. So that is the reason why sexuality is such a complex thing, because it is neither completely physical nor completely social. Hormones are chemicals which are released in, you know, in people's bodies. So the issue of sex includes a great number of features. Psychological definition of androgyny. Though definitions of androgyny vary throughout the scientific community, it is generally supported that androgyny represents a blending of traits associated with both masculinity and femininity. In psychological study, various measures have been used to characterize gender, such as the BAME sex role inventory, the personal attributes questionnaire. So psychology is another aspect of sexuality. One may have the physical features of a male, but if that person is psychologically female, then the sexuality is complicated, would be androgynous, may not be androgynous. So androgynous, we will call somebody's sexuality androgynous. So that person could feel that that person is both male and female, or that person has both male and female characteristics. So this feeling or this psychological identification with both genders, that will distinguish one as androgynous or intersex. Therefore, not only physical sexuality, but psychological sexuality is also of great importance. And there are cases where a female psyche is lodged in a male body, or a male psyche is lodged in a female body. And therefore, these persons have the difficulties in coming to terms with their sexuality, physical sexuality, and such persons could, you know, would like to have sex change or so on, so that the psyche of the person and the body of the person, there is no conflict between these two. But that is not easy, in developed countries it is more common, because sex change is an extremely expensive as well as to some extent risky operation. So we may imagine that there will be, in a country like India, there will be crores of people who are androgynous or who have difficulty in distinguishing their sexuality, and the androgynous people are called by different names in different societies. In India they are called hijras. But one is a hijra or androgynous only if that person feels that he or she has both features of male and female. So psychology, what the person feels or what the person thinks is also very important, and psychologists use some methods like a questionnaire, personal attributes questionnaire or BAME sex role inventory to find out whether that person is androgynous or not. Broadly speaking, masculine traits are categorized as agentic and instrumental, dealing with assertiveness and analytical skill. Feminine traits are categorized as communal and expressive, dealing with empathy and subtlety. So on the one hand, we talk about stereotyping of sex in public mentality. On the other hand, we see that psychologists themselves, they assume that the male mind has features like being an agent, agentic, and being an agent or instrumental, being an instrument, that is one who acts and one who asserts himself and one who has analytical skill. So it is assumed that these are masculine traits. So if these traits are in somebody, then that person is more likely to have a masculine psyche. And being communal and expressive. Communal means that you have relationship or easy relationship with the community. That is, you bond with the community very well. This has traditionally been thought to be a female characteristic. Because whether it is the family, whether it is a sisterhood, whether it is friendship, we always see that females bond very well. Males do not bond so well, they tend to be more individualistic. Therefore, communal and expressive. So, expressing oneself, that is also a female feature. So, sometimes we, tend to think that women talk more, men remain silent. Now, these stereotypes, they are not 100% correct, but they have some basis. Because females are more expressive, at least that is what the psychologists tell us. So they express themselves more than men. And they have empathy and subjectivity. Androgynous individuals exhibit behavior that extends beyond what is normally associated with their given sex. Let me correct the American spelling. Due to the position of both masculine and feminine characteristics, androgynous individuals have access to a wider array of psychological competencies with regards to emotional regulation, communication styles, and situational adaptability. Therefore, one would assume that androgynous people are more perfect than men or women because they have a wider array of psychological competencies. An androgynous person may be extremely good in sports, very athletic, like a man. At the same time, very expressive and with a communal bond, having empathy for others, which are female characteristics. So such combination or such wide array of characteristics, psychological competence, that cannot be seen in men and women. They have greater emotional regulation, communication, and adaptability. Androgynous individuals have also been associated with higher levels of creativity and mental health. So this is what the psychologists tell us. We will skip the way of measuring whether one is androgynous or not. The same sex role inventory and personal attributes questionnaire. But we just note that these are the methods by which psychologists measure whether somebody is androgynous or not. Gender identity of the androgynous people. An individual's gender identity, a personal sense of one's own gender, may be described as androgynous if they feel that they have both masculine and feminine aspects. So, the person concerned, if he feels that he has both masculine and feminine aspects, only then he can be, called androgynous. Because you remember that every human being has some male and female features, both in terms of hormone or in terms of the mind, the psyche, and so on. But everybody does not feel androgynous. So, this is very important because this helps one to identify one's gender identity. The word androgyne can refer to a person who does not fit neatly into one of the typical masculine or feminine gender roles of the society, or to a person whose gender is a mixture of male and female, not necessarily half and half. more good, we more male, less female, more female, less male. After thousands of years, finally we have come to terms with this idea that there is a gender beyond male and female. So today, even in our official forms, there is either a slot for third gender or others. That is male, female, others. So others may be any other gender or sexual identity. So this has been possible after thousands of years of neglect of the idea that androgynous people should be humanized. Or sexual identity is not only confined to male and female. Many androgynous individuals identify as being mentally or emotionally both masculine and female. So this is very important. Whether a person is androgynous or not depends upon their identification of themselves as both masculine and female. They may also identify as gender neutral, gender queer, or non-binary. These are different terms which more or less refer to the androgynous identity. A person who is androgynous may engage freely in what is seen as masculine or feminine behaviors as well as tasks. They have a balanced identity that includes the virtues of both men and women, and may disassociate the task with what gender they may be socially or physically assigned. So, if people do not recognize somebody as androgynous, they would call him either a man or a woman. But that person does not associate himself with the behaviors of a man or a woman. So they disassociate with the task of the gender that they are ascribed to by people. People who are androgynous disregard what traits are culturally constructed specifically for males and females within a specific society. So it is a clear assertion that gender roles are culturally constructed. And when the gender roles are binary, that is, if you accept only two sex or two gender, male and female, then the androgynous people won't identify themselves with that. So they will disregard such cultural traits. And we have seen that the androgynous people in India, for example, the Hijras, they live in a close community of their own. And their behavior pattern, their social pattern, social norms, everything is different from men and women. So they have created their own space, own cultural space, we may say, where they are not supposed to behave like men or like women. So they focus on what behavior is most effective within the situational circumstance. Gender expression. So the gender expression or the gender role played by these androgynous people includes a mixture of masculine and feminine characteristics. The categories of masculine and feminine gender expression are socially constructed and rely on shared perceptions of clothing, behavior. So I am changing all the behaviors to the English slave. So Wikipedia is American. Clothing, behavior, communication style, and other aspects of presentation. So today, we see often people flouting these well-defined norms of behavior. That is, men are supposed to dress in a particular fashion, walk in a particular fashion, speak in a particular fashion. Women must behave, dress, walk, speak in a different fashion. Now, today people are flouting these norms. So, yesterday I saw rich American man, white man. He wears skirts and high heels because he loves to wear them, not because he is androgynous, not because he is not a man. He is a man, but he would still love to wear women's clothes. Now, that is not impossible. This is called cross-dressing. We have the word drag queen. Now, sometimes artists, you know, Salvador Dali, the surrealist artist, he loved to dress as a drag queen, that is, in women's clothing and so on. So people want to be free in every aspect. So all the definitions, all the compulsions which we have imposed on people, that they must dress according to a particular passion, and their gender is defined by their way of dress, clothing, you know, manner of speaking, walking and so on. That is a social construct, and therefore some people do not want to follow it. They want to profit. They rely on shared perceptions of clothing, behavior, other than style. In some cultures, androgynous gender expression has been celebrated, while in others, androgynous expression has been limited or suppressed. So in some cultures, they are well accepted. For example, in India, they are well accepted. And in some other cultures, they are repressed. To say that a cultural relationship is androgynous is to say that it lacks rigid gender roles or has blurred lines between them. Now comes the two other, you know, terms. Gender queer. The word gender queer is often used by androgynous individuals to refer to themselves. But if you have gender queer and androgynous, neither equivalent nor is a gender. Gender queer is not specific to androgynous and does not denote gender identity. It may refer to any person with gender or transgender whose behavior falls outside conventional gender norms. So, the term queer, today we have a whole discipline of studies called queer studies. Now, queer does not necessarily mean that one is queer because one has sexual ambiguity. No. Anybody can decide to be a queer. So a man, if he decides to be queer, if he decides to be free of the, you know, definitions of gender and behavior, he may dress like a woman or behave like a woman and so on. But that does not mean that he has the sexual features of a woman or that he is androgynous. Therefore, androgynous and gender queer, they are not synonymous. But sometimes androgynous people use the word gender queer to refer to themselves. So a gender queer could be any person, cisgender or transgender. Now, I will next discuss these two terms, cisgender and transgender, whose behavior falls outside conventional gender norms. Furthermore, genderqueer, by virtue of its ties with queer culture, carries socio-political connotations which androgyny does not carry. So, queer, being queer means deliberately behaving in a particular manner and making a socio-political statement that I do not accept certain socio-political dictates on me. So behaving like a queer means making certain socio-political statements. But androgynous does not have any socio-political connotation. It is physical, purely physical connotation, having the features of both sexes. For these reasons, some androgynous may find the label gender queer inaccurate, inapplicable, or offensive. terms such as bisexual, heterosexual and homosexual have placed many for androgynous individuals who do not identify as men or women to begin with. So, if we believe in the binary nature of sexuality, that is, there are only two sexes, male and female, then these terms have meaning. Bisexual means one who has sexual desire for both men and women. Heterosexual means one who has sexual desire for the opposite sex. Homosexual means one who has sexual desire for the same sex. But these terms are meaningful only for people who are non-androgynous, that is, who have the features of only one sex. So for androgynous people, these terms are meaningless. Infrequently, the words gynophilia and androphilia are used. Gynophilia means love for the female sexuality, androphilia love for the male sexuality, and some describe themselves as androsexual. These words refer to the gender of the person someone is attracted to. So when we say gynophilia, we suggest that an androgynous person who is attracted to a woman. When we say androphilia, it says an androgynous person who is attracted to a man. These words but do not imply any particular gender on the part of the person who is feeling the attraction. So, is it clear so far?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Let us look at the terms transgender and cisgender. Cisgender means the gender with which one is born. Most people who are assigned female at birth identify as girls or women, and most people who are assigned male at birth identify as boys or men. These people are cisgender. That is, the gender with which one is born or assigned by the hospital, by the doctors, one carries on with the same gender, then such a person is a cisgender. But some people who have gender identity that does not match the sex they are given at birth. For example, they are born with a vulva, vagina and uterus, but they identify as male. These people are transgender or trans. So, now transgender, one who identify themselves as different from the pre-assigned gender, such a person is a transgender. Such a person actually may have the problem of a female psyche lodged in a male body or a male psyche lodged in a female body. In any case, they go beyond the pre-assigned gender, that is why they are called transgender. And in the acronym LGBTQ, T trans stands for transgender. L is lesbian, G is gay, B bisexual, T transgender, Q queer, and I intersex, and there are many others. Trans can also include people who don't identify strict male, female gender roles. Other people who don't identify either male or female for themselves gender queer. There are other gender identity terms and labels. Alright, so are these terms clear to you? Transgender and cisgender?
Sir, bujhte parlam na clearly, are you bolben arekto?
So people are assigned a particular sex when they are born, in their birth certificate by the doctors. So somebody is assigned female, and if that person in her later life also remains a woman or feels being a woman, then she see the cisgender. Somebody is assigned the sexuality of male in his birth certificate. If it is later life also, throughout his life, he remains a man, he feels like a man, then he is cisgender. But those who in their later lives feel that they are not what they have been assigned, that is, the doctors who assign the sex at the time of birth, they do it on the basis of the physical characteristics or features of the genitalia. But it is quite clear that in spite of having female features, a person may later feel to be a man. Or, in spite of having male sexual features, that person may later feel like being a woman. Such people are transgender because they are not what they were assigned at birth. Their gender is different, which they realize later as they grow up. Is it clear?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
So once a baby is born, the baby is given a sexual definition by the doctors in its birth certificate. And then the baby is taught by society regarding behavior, norms, you know, how to dress, how to speak, how to talk. And if they can follow that perfectly, so a baby who is a female, if she always behaves like a woman as she is taught, that is the gender role which society teaches her. If she performs the gender role satisfactorily, then there is no problem with her sexuality. She is a woman, she feels being a woman, and the features of a woman as well. But sometimes we see that some girls, and we call them girls, but they, as they grow up, they realize that they have a male mind or a male psyche. They behave more like boys, they love to play with boys, or, you know, they love to dress like boys, wear their hair short, and so on and so forth. Which means that they cannot perform the gender role which society is teaching them. And why they cannot do that, there may be many reasons, but definitely their sexuality has something different from the preconceived or predefined sexuality which was assigned to them at birth. These people will be transgender because they will realize that they have a different gender. So if you do not have any other question on androgyny, then we can switch over to some of the book. Do you have any question on androgyny? Are you clear about a binary definition of sexuality is found to be inadequate for people who are non-binary. That is, they could be androgynous, they could be transgender, they could be homosexual, or they could be, they could have any kind of different sexual identity that they feel that their gender is different. So, gender identity does not have much to do with sexual identity or the physical features of the genitalia. So, as I told you that so many different things decide one's gender. Some of these, only some of these are physical features, but there are social, psychological, hormonal features which also decide sexuality. And this actually becomes an issue in the field of sports, because there are different criteria for sports among men and women. So the competition cannot be, or often mostly the competition is in the same sex. So women compete with women and men compete with men. But in order to increase one's athletic quality, women sometimes would take additional testosterone hormone, which is the male hormone, that builds muscles, sometimes leads to the growth of hair, facial hair, and male sexual features may become visible if there is too much of testosterone in somebody's body. And therefore, before participating in any major sports event, athletes have to take a urine test where the percentage of the hormones are measured. And sometimes they will be debarred from participating, or even their medals may be taken away if it is found that at the time of the sports event, that person was more of a man than a woman. How could that be measured? By the presence of the male hormone in her urine. So, therefore, you see, the definition of man and woman depends upon a number of things, and apart from the binary of male and female, there are so many other sexual identities. Any question?
এই যে মানে বললেন যে হোমোসেক্সুয়াল পিপল আর যে পিপলগুলো থাকে মানে যারা নয় মেল নয় ফিমেল, তো স্যার দুটো এই পিপলকে কি আমরা অ্যান্ড্রোজিনাস পিপল বলতে পারি? দুটোর মধ্যে স্যার কি ডিফারেন্স রয়েছে? হ্যাঁ,
হোমোসেক্সুয়াল, লেসবিয়ান, গে, দে আর নট অ্যান্ড্রোজিনাস. Because androgynous people feel that they are both male and female. They have both masculine and feminine features. Like in the Gira community in our country. So, at the time of birth, if somebody finds that the baby has physical features which are uncertain, or physical features which indicate some difficulty, some anomaly, then such a baby is rejected by the family because it is androgynous. And we know that after the birth of the baby, the Hijra community, they visit the houses, and if they find that the baby is androgynous, then they take the baby. So, an androgynous person will have some physical features that do not conform to our definition of male or female. But that is not the case with the homosexuals. Homosexual means desire for the same sex. So, if a woman is homosexual, then she is called a lesbian, which means that she has a desire for a woman, not a man. If a man is homosexual, then he has a desire for a man and not a woman. Such a man is called gay. But a greater number of people are actually bisexual. According to Freud, desire for being homosexual is there in most men and women, in most people, but it is suppressed by socio-cultural conditions, because for thousands of years homosexuality was not accepted or not looked upon as acceptable. Many religions look upon it as a sin and so on and so forth. So homosexuality had for many, many, you know, centuries a stigma attached with it. Today, of course, this stigma is no longer there, or it is almost going. So the fact that some people desire people of the same sex is almost as natural as heterosexuality, that is, people desiring people of the opposite sex. And homosexuality is not, in that sense, an abnormality, because it is natural and it can be found also among animals. So the terms gay, lesbian, bisexual, these terms all refer to what kind of sexual desire a person has. On the other hand, the term androgynous refers to the fact that a person has not only, you know, primarily that a person has both male and female sexual physical features, but a homosexual person, whether a man or a woman, from the outside you will not understand that that person is different from other people. But androgynous person can very easily be identified as being different from non-androgynous.
Yes, sir.